summer is speaking on us. We're getting hot days, cold days, but it's summer coming. So I really want to thank everyone for taking the time out to briefly join us this morning for this really important process that we are about to embark on here in outreach. So my name is Debbie Canton, and I'm the president and CEO of Outreach. On behalf of the Board of Directors and the staff and the person served, welcome to the groundbreaking ceremony for our latest capital endeavor, the 25-bed transitional residence for young adults. Outreach was founded over 40 years ago in Queens with one goal in mind: to help build healthy lives. Our mission is to inspire individuals and families to achieve a life of unlimited potential by developing and delivering the highest quality evidence-based behavioral health services and training. Since 1979, we have expanded our reach to include multiple of programs to meet the needs of the community. This program is another step in our quest to assist individuals as they navigate their way through recovery. Today marks a new beginning for our youth battling addiction on Long Island. We are proud to be in a position to offer them a safe alternative to life on the streets, one that is supportive and to celebrate them and to become who they want to be. Our approach is both caring and collaborative and working to reunite families torn apart by misuse. The COVID pandemic, along with substance use, has created many challenges for the people we serve, highlighting the need for our services even more. As many of you know, we cut the ribbon and opened the doors to our recovery residents for women right here on the campus, which is across the pathway. And we did that two years ago, actually at the height and beginning of the pandemic. Last year, we partnered with Western Suffolk BOCES to create the Aspire Academy, which is the first of its kind in the downstate region of New York State to serve high school students from both Nassau and Suffolk counties. Aspire encompasses the typical school year plus an extended component for students in the summer months. Outreach provides an array of services centering on recovery, support, sustain, and gain made by young people and their families during the treatment episode. As you can see, we have continued to forge ahead. Today, we are honored to have representation from our funders, elected officials, the community, and persons served. We also know it takes a village, and we look forward to collaborating bringing unique and diverse offerings here in Brentwood. Today, I'm happy to have the Executive Committee of Outreach here with me. If you could please stand wherever you are so I can just thank you. My right hand, my left hand. Physician, believe it or not, before that at Montefiore Health System, and a professor Sciences at the Albert Einstein College of Medicine. Dr. Cunningham has more than 20 years' experience in research, care, and program development that focuses on people who use drugs. She has also partnered with community-based organizations to develop pioneering programs to promote the health of this population. Dr. Cunningham led one of the first clinics in New York City to integrate buprenorphine into primary care, which is really groundbreaking. She has trained hundreds of doctors to treat substance abuse disorder in primary care, and she has led several research studies and published numerous articles. Please welcome me. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Cunningham to Long Island, to outreach, and just to the field in general. We are blessed. grow over the years. I've been to a number of groundbreakings and ribbon cuttings. And I'm sorry I'm not able to stay for the entire ceremony today, but please know that we are here with you. David Mazzini from your program sits on our advisory board. We care, we're concerned, we are here to partner with you to help in any way we can and to employ you in the incredible good work you do and the difference you've made in so many lives and will continue to do so. Thank you.
Where we met my uncle, and soon after, group was really sketches. A lot more students. We had AC, smart boards, and it was a very positive experience. I started school in fifth grade. By sixth grade, I was already helping my teacher teach half of the class. By seventh grade, I began speaking and understanding English. I attended to school from sixth until 11th grade in high school. At 13, I began barbering. A friend of my uncle owned a barber shop, and I would spend a lot of time watching him cut hair. A bakery owner I knew, and my stepdad would allow me to practice cutting hair. Soon after, I quickly learned the skill and began cutting regularly. My uncle's friends saw how talented I was and allowed me to begin working in his shop. I worked there for approximately 1 year. My uncle friend lost his shop and moved to another shop. I followed him there and continued cutting hair. This went on for a few years, moving from shop to shop. Moving here was an outpatient in Ukraine. I faced a few obstacles as well. One obstacle was my language barrier. Although I learned English, I didn't know many words. I had a hard time in English class. My strong accent didn't help. This would frustrate me often. Like in El Salvador, I also fought a lot in school. Because I was popular, many people challenged me often, and being a man of respect like my father, I accept all challenges. I also was involved in several car accidents. I was pulled over several times by police with drugs on me, and was involved in a few high-speed chases with the police, which resulted in several accidents. In general, there was a lot of violence in my life. There were many things I was involved with. I wish I had experienced growing up on going shootouts were not foreign to me. I have also been on the other side of a gun as well. I had a gun pointed to my chest and also my head. I lost my teeth, broke my nose, and busted my lips. Riding a dirt bike, which I went to a coma for like 7 days. There were all life-changing experiences, and many I regret. Another life-changing experience was the divorce of my parents. My father and I were very close. He always spoke to me when there was a problem, opposed to being more angry. I really miss him. Moving to America was a blessing and also a curse because I lost contact with my father, who was dear to me. This hurts a lot. As I said, I was very popular and included both the good and the bad crowd. And I was told when I was young that I had a heart condition. I shouldn't ever do drugs. However, hanging out with the wrong crowd made it difficult. I was always curious about drugs and began my research. My curiosity grew, and I began smoking cigarettes, which later led me to alcohol, marijuana. This caused me to graduate to harder drugs. And I began using regularly, which unfortunately ultimately turned me to an addict. I began becoming a bad influence to those around me. I had relationships with several females and introduced them to drug dealers. sweet day that there is hope for others like me. To those of you in similar shoes, I leave you with a blessed words. Never look for a permanent solution to a temporary problem. Thank you.
Thank you, and I want to thank Christine, and I want to thank John Benson in the back there. and really all the people that are helping in this field. One thing I did early on was I just realized that I had this one theory that I tell a lot of people. It's like, I call it the string of pearls, right? Because there's so many people doing so good work, and I hope Dr. Cunningham, we had a wonderful talk. And she and I hit it off right away because she has young children, I have young children. We both are passionate about the fact that we want to help the next person, the next dentist, right? Dennis, those words were wonderful. Thank you for sharing them with us. And I just love how Christine, every time we come to outreach, we do the spring luncheon, she always has somebody telling a real life story of their journey, right? Because it hits us right in the heart, and it gives us fodder to go forward and to work harder, right? Because in my opinion, we're not doing enough. You know, I'm not doing enough, right? I need to do more as Ranker, right? I teamed up with Chairman Phil Steck, I teamed up with the Senate Chairman and Ranker. We just held a wonderful all-day seminar on co-occurring disorders out of Wellbridge a couple weeks ago, and John was part of that working group that we put together. But when I talk about the string of pearls, I talk about the fact that there's so many groups out there that are doing such great work, but there's no one stringing the pearls together, right? And working together. So what I did was I formed the Long Island Drug Coalition to bring all the groups together on one big tent. Let's work together. Let's figure it out. And why it's relevant to Dr. Cunningham is the thing we talked about was integrated care for co-occurring disorders, right? And for those who don't know what that means, it's a fancy word to say that mental health and substance abuse are integrally linked, right? Which comes first, the chicken or the egg, right? With my nephew, my sister, and I'll never forget what she said this after he passed. My sister said to me, I'm convinced that Jesse was bipolar. And so when I was having my own struggles with my own family, you know, I reached out to Christine and she was wonderful to help me out, and John was wonderful to help me out. And my son is doing extremely well. But I saw the same patterns in him that I saw with Jesse, and I didn't want him to go down that road. So when I talked to Dr. Cunningham, I said, Dr. Cunningham, the world is not siloed, right? The world doesn't work like that. We in government, we love to put everything in a nice little box, right? But the world doesn't work like that. Things overlap. Things are intertwined, right? So the number one priority we have right now is getting OASIS and OMH to merge. And for me, the reason I put together that seminar was I teamed up with a woman from Westchester. She spoke at a panel discussion in Albany. And I went right up to her right afterwards and I said, that was amazing. I said, we have to team up, we have to talk, right? So Stephanie Marcusano lost her son to a heroin overdose too. So immediately we bonded, right? And Stephanie told me that she had done a seminar on co-occurring disorders of Westchester, sponsored by Westchester Medical Health Center and Montefiore Medical Center. So I said, Stephanie, can we please bring that dog and pony show down to Long Island? Let's do that here on Long Island. And we just held this seminar. We had people coming from all over Long Island. And the wonderful thing about it is, and what we're truly working on right now, is working with OASIS, working with OMH, and trying to figure out best practices. Because when the rubber meets the road, is how do we help more young people, right? How do we give them the coping tools to deal with the pressures that they have today? We're seeing this just play out time and time again. You know, with what happened in Buffalo, what happened in Texas, the horrible, you know, occurrences that are almost on a daily basis now. There's a reason for that, right? We gotta give kids hope. We gotta give kids a feeling that they're not isolated, that they're not alone, right? And the best way we can do that is by reaching out and connecting them, right? Because they can't sit in their bedrooms playing video games all day. These goddamn phones are the worst thing ever invented. They're evil. I swear to God, I hate them, you know? And that's what's driving some of these kids. They just, you know, with social media, with video games and everything else, they just fall more and more into the abyss. So I'll get off my soapbox now, because I can talk for hours about this issue, because it's so relevant to everything that's happening today with young people. You know, one other thing I'm trying to do, I sponsored a bill that just got money for Northport High School to start a peer-to-peer mentor program. And I'm working with the Northport Drug and Alcohol Task Force. And John Benson knows, Anthony Ferentino, who was my son's drug and alcohol counselor. We're working together with the school district, the superintendent, the principal, to try to make sure that every ninth grader that's coming to Gulfport High feels connected to the school community, that they don't feel isolated. Because I remember the first day I walked into Northwood High School, I walked into the Commons, and it's a room about 10 times the size of this room, and I went, holy crap, what the hell's going on here? And I felt just alone in that moment, you know? And you take that, multiply it by the 1,200 kids that are going to Northwood High now, and I guarantee you, it's more than just a couple of high-risk kids that are in that class. It's probably most of that class. And we need to do peer-to-peer mentoring to get those kids together so that they don't feel isolated anymore. So I just want to, I said a few thank yous, but I just, the person who's sitting, should be sitting next to me, Senator Phil Boyle, just so you know, session ended for the Senate in the Assembly last night at 3 a.m. Phil's still up in Albany. I have the benefit of zooming in because I had double knee replacement surgery. So I went to bed at 3 a.m. in my own cozy bed, and Phil had to go find his hotel room. But Phil did tell me, I texted him, and he apologized for not being here, but we're losing a great public servant, Phil Boyle. Phil Boyle was the dean of the Long Island delegation. He served about a total of 30 years between the Assembly and the Senate, and he just told me to say this. Please just congratulate them on my behalf for the groundbreaking. Let them know that since I'm not seeking re-election to the State Senate, it's truly been an honor partnering with Outreach over the years. Thank you so much. So thank you all for being here. Thank you for what you're doing to help young people out today. And God bless.
Chief Fiscal Officer Tony Prochi. My office is next to Tony, and I can always tell when he's on the phone with them. He is so passionate about moving this work along and getting it done. Thank you, Tony, for your leadership. And to the crew that's working with Tony, we also want to thank you, and that's Dazzy. You are working on behalf of Oasis, but you are a true partner in this regard. Thank you. And the architects of H2M, we also want to thank you. Your diligence on this project, we really are happy for that. And most, and last but not least, the contractors at Rapinelli. We want to also thank you. Every Thursday, this group meets in that building over there. I join in by Zoom for parts of it, and I have to tell you, it's about getting this project completed. And we definitely want to thank you all for your work on this. So with that, we'll close the formal piece, and we'll move outside to do the ceremony piece. And again,